As you can see, the title of my presentation is Canoe Making a Journey, and that's the same title that we're using for what has been being called a manual for canoe carving that SHI is producing, and I've turned in the manuscript and the photographs for it, so it's in the works. And it's written not as like an overview of canoe making or something like that. It's really a kind of a personal journey of how to, and things that I've learned along the way, and to a certain extent where they come from. So people have asked me, well, how did you get into canoe carving? And well, first one I made was in 1973, and that was because I'd seen two canoes that Bill Holm had made in the San Juan Islands at a summer camp that he's been associated with since he was a teenager. And I thought the idea that you could make the tools to make this beautiful boat was just too much, and I just fell in love with the idea and wanted to make one. And then I had opportunities to make others, which meant that I had the opportunity to try different things, because not everything you read, not everything you hear is accurate. And the only way to find that out is to try it and see. So some things I was taught, some things I was told work, and some of them don't. So I've made now 14 in the last 40-something years, and I still don't think I've made one that I really think reflects the standards and the consistency of the old canoes. I mean, I think a lot of times people underestimate what they are.
Yeah, it's a
dugout, it's hollow log, how tough can it be? But to get up to the standards that they set and the consistent product that was created over hundreds of miles and many, many generations is a much bigger challenge than I think people give it. So I've had the opportunity to work with a few old-timers. With the exception of one person who was 100 years old in 1976 that we visited on Vancouver Island from Nia Bay when I was working with some macaw fellows on the canoes that are in that museum in Nia Bay. We took one of them across to Vancouver Island to visit Charlie Jones. And he had made a canoe 3 years before that, in 97, with another younger guy. But otherwise, there's really the people who made these have been gone for a long time. Mostly canoes stopped being made right around 1910 by 1920. And I think the reason was, or one of the reasons, was because people, the canoe builders, learned how to make plank boats. Plank boats are lighter, stronger. You don't have the Achilles heel of a carved canoe that is cracks. And you don't have to keep them out of the sun all the time. You don't have the same problems. And so people, you can see the transition, even in photographs of Sitka here. Earlier photographs, there's a lot of canoes, and then little by little, there's more and more plank boats from fishing skiffs and rowing boats up into small schooners and whatnot. There were, and many Native people became well known as boat builders in this community and many others. So, and a lot of those I think were former canoe builders. So anyway, as you can see, this was sponsored by the Park Service and SHI, and they were both fantastic. We encountered a lot of problems along the way, but they were very helpful and stuck with us all the way. The four guys, Tommy, Joseph, Jerrod, and Nick Galanin, and DJ Young, who worked with me, were just fantastic. I'm sorry none of them could be here today. I really wanted to give them a chance to be recognized and appreciated. on their own. But at any rate, we'll forge ahead here. So the things I've learned the most from are old photographs, unfinished canoes that I managed to see a handful of, that were left in the woods, not finished for some reason, decades or generations ago. And they're very instructive, because it's like, this is what this person did first, and this is how they progressed. You know, you see different unfinished ones in different stages of completion. And the other thing is historic photographs, and there are very few. I saw another one today that I wasn't even aware of, that Lewis Shelbridge had taken of steaming a cottonwood canoe, someone steaming a cottonwood canoe up at Tlemcen. And I've managed to find a number of those and put them in my collection. But oddly enough, none of the 19th century, early 20th century photographers, or very few of them, took it upon themselves to document much of the process. And if they saw somebody or heard of somebody steaming a canoe, maybe they went and took a picture, you know. And I think maybe in those days, the very ubiquitousness of the canoes, I mean, there were hundreds of them around. Every village, look at any old village picture from before 1900, and there's always several dozen canoes in each village. And then, so I think they weren't maybe valued as much by outsiders as they would have been if there weren't so many of them. And they quickly disappeared once they stopped being made. They succumbed to the elements relatively quickly because they're thin, because they develop cracks, and you know, next thing you know, they're gone. But this picture here is a contemporary photograph of an unfinished canoe on Haidawai. And, well, yeah, it's just kind of a mossy old log there in the woods. And I've seen one other in person and another photograph of one on Haidawai. But this itself has a lot to teach. It shows you where the rise of the ends takes place right here. It shows you how the gunwale is straight and level to the same point here at the opposite end. I'm assuming this is the bow, but it might not be. And then you can see that the outward curve of the log has been retained because you want to keep that outside surface just under the bark is the newest, the most live, the most resilient, the most responsive wood that you want to, especially when you go to bend it out, to steam it out, to make the canoe bigger than the log was, you really want to stay in that prime wood. So this shows you exactly what that carver did in probably the first few days, or maybe as much as a week of work. The other one is roughly 1890-ish picture of a group of guys, actually the whole photograph, there's about five fellows in there, all banging away with axes, finishing the hauling of that canoe. It's probably at least a 40-foot canoe. And again, you can see how this from a different, slightly angle, but you can see where this part is dropping down, because as you steam it out, the ends don't change, they don't bend. But then starting here, the sides are captive within the shape of the log, and then they run straight that way from one end to the other where it curves up and becomes the opposite end. You can also see that the gunwales, the top edge here, is level wrong in here, and then it starts to twist. By the time it gets here, it's tipping radically inward. And that's because when the sides steam out, they go out and down and they become level. So if you start with them level, they end up slanting outward like this. So there are a lot of those little things that you have to learn to anticipate, and some of them are very specific. If it's not tipped enough, it doesn't look right when you're done. Now, you might say that, well, you could just leave extra wood there and then carve it off after you get it shaped. But there are, in fact, features of that shape along the gunwale. There's a hollow on the inside, very deliberate. It doesn't appear to need to be there. and a similar one on the outside because the top of the gun was wider than the canoe was thick. So without that hollow on the inside, I think the reason that that's there, and it's almost always there, in certain types of canoes it's always there, is to thin out that cross section so that it will bend more easily. So unless you do that first, you don't get the advantage of it bending more easily. If you leave extra wood, you don't get the advantage of it bending more easily. So you have to carve it to finish shape and anticipate the changes accurately and then go from there. Here's one really great picture. I've seen it attributed to Southeast Alaska and British Columbia, so I'm not sure where it is. But here's a guy and maybe his son and a woman steaming a canoe. He's got a split stick in his hand. He's transferring hot rocks from the fire to the bit of water in the canoe. And on the canoe hull itself, you can see a pattern of holes that are weeping steam. And those holes are the part of the measuring system of how you know how thick the canoe is, the hull is, as you're hauling it out. So you don't have to climb in and out and feel around all the time. You just drill these holes deeply, put a measured peg in there as long as you want the side to be thick, which changes in different parts of the canoe from the bottom to the top to the ends. And you drive those in, and when you're hauling it out, you find the end of the holes, and then you can stick something in that hole to tell exactly how far you are to the inside surface of the canoe. You carve right down to it. There are many of these ingenious methods involved in this that the old timers pioneered, and that are used elsewhere in the world as well. There's a video on YouTube of some guys up in Finland carving a canoe out of what looks like an aspen log or something like that. And they drill holes and they put pegs in it and they steam them out and drink. So, but here I think they developed that process to a more refined degree than anywhere else in the world. And the other picture is from when we steamed the canoe here last September, the September before last, down at the back beach. And there'll be more views of that shortly. And this picture is of the second canoe that Bill Holm made. And I got to see this the year he made it. I was 17 at the time. And I wasn't there long enough to work with him. I'd known Bill for a period of time before that, but I got to see it, and just to know that somebody can actually do this, you know, a real person and not a godlike image of the past, you know. And so that really helped me to fall in love with the whole idea. So here it is. Before it was steamed out, you can see again those same characteristics, the straight sides. So that's all made to fit inside the log. And then below that is the one where it's been widened up. I'm not sure what the original measurement was, but it went out to 5 feet, and you can tell it's quite a bit wider. The sides are all curved, they're not straight. The ends come up higher because the bottom flexes as the sides go out. The ends get closer together. The only way they can do that is if the bottom bends up. And then, like I said, it was made for a summer camp in the San Juans, and so I actually was a counselor there when I was 19 and 20, and we took 15, 16-year-old boys like this, paddling and sailing all around the San Juan Islands. And that was in the early 70s. And so, part of the relationship with these that I began to develop. On the left here, I only recently encountered this picture. It was taken by a photographer named LaRoche out of Seattle. A couple of Tlingit women on the Dyea River. You can see they're toting a lot of freight, just the two of them. And the fact that they're probably going upstream, they must be following an eddy along the side to be able to make their way upstream. But my God, look at the shape of that. Look at the rear end on that canoe. It is beautiful. The other one is a canoe 25 feet long that Will Burkhardt and I carved in Melicata. in 1983. It was launched in January 84. And that was the first time I'd inquired a log that had came with crack problems in it. And the fellow there in the bow, Jack Booth, he's the one that went out in the same boat single-handedly, knocked down the tree, bucked it off, towed it back down. I wasn't going to ask him to go out and get another one. So we had to deal with these cracks, and we did it in a way that I'll show later. And that was the fifth canoe that I had made, and the first northern style. The others had all been macaw style canoes, and four of those are in the museum out there in the bay. And then in 87, I'd gotten the opportunity to work with George Dalton Stubble Kaw, who had, as a young boy of like 12, had worked with his father. His father regularly made spruce canoes for hunting sea otter and seal and whatnot. And George wanted to see it done again the way his father did it. And this was in 87. There was a few canoes being made by that time elsewhere, British Columbia and whatnot. And but he wanted us to use the same tools. So we just used a two-person crosscut saw. It was me and Mick Beasley. And as you can see, axe, adzes, and whatnot, but all hand tools. And it took a little longer than the other way, but not that much when you think about it. There's actually a limited amount of use that a chainsaw can perform on a canoe. And they tend to be big, kind of gross cuts and things like that. They're great for hauling out. You can see chopping down with an axe and all that. It's a little bit slower. And the spruce itself is a little slightly more difficult to work with. I thought we could have made two cedar canoes the same size in the same amount of time. So that's over there in Glacier Bay. And then Mick and I made another one in Hona that's over there now. And this other one was about 1990. The Tom Heritage Center in Ketchikan wanted to do a canoe making workshop and make a canoe. So we chose one. The proportions of two that John Wallace of Heidelberg had made in the 1930s. He made them for sale. One's now in the State Museum here, in Juneau, and the other one's in the Burke, in Seattle, Burke Museum. And they're 14 feet long and 37 inches wide, steamed out and everything. So we, and this happened to be the only actual perfect log I ever had access to. It's the only one I got to pick out in the forest. And said, we'll take that one. And they took it down, handled it with straps instead of hydraulic, forks and stuff. And it didn't have any rod in it, didn't have any cracks in it. I don't even think there was a knot in it, except, in the hull itself, in the middle maybe. And there were five participants and myself in the workshop. And we launched the canoe on the afternoon of the eighth day of work. And that was steamed out of Fort San Gunn Street on the edge here we are batting off on lunch day. Fred Paddock in the bow, he was one of the participants, and I don't know whose little boy that is, but he jumped in as we went on. Another great learning tool are these drawings, this kind of grid drawing that is common in the boat building world is related to lofting. And it's a pattern of lines either parallel to the center line or parallel to the water line, and stations across the hull at given intervals. And that grid that's produced will reveal in two dimensions every three-dimensional aspect of the hull. It's better than a photograph. It's almost better than seeing the canoe in person. And it's just great. So these are all existing canoes of the type we made here. This one's in the American Museum of Natural History. It happens to be the biggest one in existence, 64 feet long. and 8 feet, 2 inches wide. Now, I can't reach 8 feet, the height, typical ceiling height in a modern home. Imagine that. And that was made in Bella Bella in 1801. It's usually referred to as a Haida canoe, but it's a hillside canoe, Bella Bella. And this one was made in 1908 by Alfred and Robert Davidson in Massett, originally for the Alaska Pacific Yukon Exposition in Seattle, 1909. But they wouldn't pay him enough. They only offered him $200 for it. It's a 55-foot canoe. So they said, forget it, went back. There's a great story of taking it over to Massa, but it's too long to tell. Maybe a first time later. And then they got in touch with somebody on their behalf, got in touch with what was then the National Museum of Canada, and they offered him $500, and they took it.
National Museum of
Land. Well, originally it was the National Museum of Canada, then it was the Museum of Man, then it was the Canadian Museum of Civilization, and now it's the Canadian Museum of History. So, I don't, they keep changing it. The other one, this one is a 37-foot canoe. Now, these are the type, these three are the type I'm chosen to call a northern ceremonial canoe. They tended to be the big ones. They're the ones that were painted on the ends and all that. They had this kind of a double flare to the gunwale and the ends, much larger blocks on the ends that we'll see later. And they were seemed to be exclusively for bigger, more visible kinds of events, you know, traveling to Korea, that kind of thing. And the other everyday canoes were a single flare at the gunwale. And they were, except down south, down in British Columbia, they painted them up. But up here, they were just, in Southeast Alaska, they were always black, just plain black. Like a Model T. And there are numerous examples, of course, that have carved additions, you know, bow pieces, stern pieces added on for to add crest images and whatnot. But they're pretty much always black. This one's 37 feet, and it's in the Burke Museum in Seattle. It came from Alert Bay to Seattle in 1895, and has been in the museum ever since. This other one is in the Canadian Museum of History now, and it's just 18 feet, 8 inches long, and it was made, I think, for the museum. It was commissioned by an anthropologist, I forget which, might have been Dawson, but I could be wrong about that. And it's a beautiful canoe, incredible shape, and it was carved in shape, it wasn't steamed out. Bill Reed and I were there one time and we were specifically looking at that canoe because it was when he was starting to make his first one in 85 or 6. And you could tell by the pattern of the grain in the gunwales that it had been carved in that shape. And that wasn't uncommon. So one of those that was in that last picture, in fact, I'll go back to you because I didn't get to it. This is the one in the Smithsonian National Museum of Natural History. This was the Hootsyap of Shakes, and it's 44 feet long, just under 6 feet wide. And it was never painted with designs, but it had a carved bear on the front and a carved bear on the stern. And it left Wrangell at around before 1893 and went back east for an exposition in Philadelphia, one of those places. And ended up, first it was somewhere else, I forget where, Department of Forestry or something, and then it went to the Smithsonian where it is now. Although it's just in their storage building out in Suitland, Maryland. And this is what it looked like in its heyday in Wrangell Harbor. So it's 44 feet long, and there's 25 people in that canoe. And it's still floating relatively high. You can still see the vertical cutwater in the bow right down there. And there's a little tiny spruce canoe with one dive in there next to it. It looks really small there. And the other one on the left, there was the Kikyap that also belonged to Shakes. And this picture was taken in 1940 at the time of the restoration of the poles and the house there, the potlatch in June. 1940, as they referred to it at the time. And you can see it was painted up with killer whale designs, and that was done by UCAS, William UCAS. And that's, there's about 17 people in that canoe. They're all dressed in regalia, so they're heavier than they would usually be. And cruising through Rango Harbor there, and that canoe unfortunately perished in a fire in 1952. It was on a pier in downtown Rango when that side of the town, everything was on pilings, caught fire, and the canoe went with it. It was on the pier pending a shipment with the rest of the Waters collection to the Bird Museum in Seattle. And ironically, if it had stayed in this canoe shed here next to the sheikh's house where it belonged, we'd still have it today. So this is one of those grid drawings of the Hootjak, the one in the Smithsonian. These were lines taken off it by Bill Holm a number of years ago. And the beauty of it is that you can see the ones that in this end view, these horizontal lines, those are ones called water lines. And they're every 6 inches up from the bottom of the canoe. So over here, one side of this is looking down on the canoe, and this side is looking up at the bottom. So each one of those lines traveling through it horizontally, you can see that lowest one, 6 inches up from the bottom, is right here. The next one, 6 inches up from that. And so you can see how they, each one is a little wider, but they're all this long, gentle curve. There are no parallel lines in the hull after it's steamed out. And then going the other way, the vertical lines, also 6 inches intervals going out from the center. Those are called butt lines. And so they show up here. So the first one, 6 inches out, is here. And you can see how it curves down. The next one and the last one, way out at the edge of the gunnel, is this line here. And so at that point, right about here, so these last two lines, somewhere in between those last two lines, is the point where the hull meets the shape of the log. And so you carve within the shape of the log, but everything below that has to be carved to its finished shape. It won't get wider down there. It'll get wider up at the gunnel level, but not down below. So if it's not already curved out, it's never going to be. The steaming won't help it. And I think a lot of people have missed that over the years. But at any rate, the tremendous amount can be gleaned from those kinds of drawings. So this is that one in, this is in the American Museum of Natural History in New York, the Helsa canoe. It was collected at Bella Bella 1881, and all the carved details in it, which include this critter there on the bow, and some of the thwarts are carved, and the painting, all that is all very much in the Helsa style. And it's a killer whale on the front and an eagle on the stern, and those are opposite moieties in the Haida system, if I understand it correctly. So it's not likely to be Haida anyway. But there it is when it was on the left, when it used to be on the floor. And if you were kind to the guards, they would let you go beyond the barrier and get up there and look in it. And standing right next to it, the bow on the floor, you had to reach like this to touch the top of the bow. And is that big? And there it is now, it's hanging from the ceiling, which is not always the best way to display a canoe, but they do take up a lot of space. So a lot of them end up that way. People talk about ones bigger than that, you know, 70, 80 feet, and I suppose it's possible, but I'm a little skeptical of that. So here's Alfred Davidson at work on his canoe. 1908, you can see the size of that. He's at the bow there. He's putting a little patch across a crack or a bark seam or something right there on the thin part of the bow at the top of the cutwater. So he's spiking on a little patch to keep that from moving. It's not yet steamed. You can see the roundness in the hull that remains the shape of the log. And there are some pictures from a very great distance. distance of it being steam. Now you can see it's a cloud of steam and some canvas over it. But here it is in finished shape in the museum in Ottawa, or Hull, Quebec, painted by Charles Edensaw. Now, and that canoe is actually quite narrow for its length. Most of them, if we hopped back to this briefly, the length to width proportions are often between one to six, that is six times the width in length. And the bigger ones tend to be different proportions. The one in New York, 65 or 64 feet, 8 feet wide, that's 8 to 1, it's 8 times its width and length. But this, the massive one is almost 9 times its width and length. It's quite narrow, but still a seaworthy canoe. The Khuchyak is 1 to 7.6. And I personally think that that canoe either wasn't steamed out as wide as it could have been, or sometime in its history the thwarts were out of it. They had to do a lot of stuff moving around back and forth and all that, so it wouldn't surprise me that they were. And it might have closed back in a little bit, because the lines suggest that it maybe should be a few inches wider, maybe another 6 inches, which would make it 1 to 7. This is 1 to 7 point something, I can't quite read it there. And the small one in, that was not steamed out is 1 to 5.3, so it's wide for its length. The one we made here is about, if I remember, it's 1 to 5.8, something like that. So it's wide for its length, and we did that on purpose because it was intended to be, you know, used with youth programs and whatnot, and so we thought the bigger, heavier, more stable, that sort of thing, might be better. Then there were two of this type here in Sitka, in the early part of the 20th century. I think both of them came up with the totem poles from down Prince of Wales Way. At least one of them, the one on the right here, belonged to Sanaha of Kassan, old Kassan. Where did my gizmo go? I lost my cursor. Anyway, and it's photographed there at the Lewis and Clark exposition in Portland in 1904 or 5, and it was also at the St. Louis World's Fair. So it traveled with the poles and then came back up here. I've only seen maybe 2 pictures of it in the park, and it was in pretty rough shape already. You can see the added block on the bow is missing, and one of the pictures I saw of it up by where the big tall Sunnycott poles are now, supposed to originally were. And it's already crumbling apart in that old photograph. It was probably 1910-ish. The other one started out, I don't know, my cursor show up. That's, oh, there it is. Elder DeMero photographed it looking like this. There's one guy in this 50-foot canoe. I'm not sure where it came from, but I believe DeMero hired a Canadian artist, I'm not sure of his name, to paint it up and spiff it up as, you know, paints a little weather and whatnot on that picture. But examining the features of the two, I'm quite sure that that's the same canoe. Now, this one in the painted up version. And this is a different canoe, you can tell by the shape of the end and whatnot. But unfortunately, neither of those have survived, and just because for lack of a roof over them, if there's a roof over them, they'll last for decades, if not 20-25 years is about the end of it if they're not used regularly and all that. And the one that we patterned ours after in many ways is this small one here. It's only 28 feet long. This is in the Royal British Columbia Museum in Victoria, and it might be one of the smallest ones of that type ever made. And here it has some kind of sailors looking, you know, the people around Victoria itself painting on it, but it was probably originally a Haida canoe. And you can see it's rigged up for oars, and a lot of old canoes were set up with oars in the 19th century because people recognized the efficiency of that, a smaller number of people, bigger amount of leverage. Oars, rudders, sails, the whole bit. So this is ours when we launched it, just to test it out before the official launching to make sure it wouldn't have any problems. And you can see there's a number of similarities, but we had a set of lines of that and measurements, and so when we kind of based the initial shaping on that canoe, but made it, like I said, a little bit wider, a little bit deeper. So when the log arrived here in Sitka, first thing we as the carvers did, I have to say first that I feel extremely privileged to have been invited to participate in that. All but the first canoe I made and one other one have been made in and for Native communities with Native apprentices. And this was another opportunity to do that, which I thought was wonderful. And those four guys, I've met them all at some point, some of them I knew relatively well, and Tommy pretty well, and Nick. But the other two, Jerrod and TJ, I had known less well. I only met them on occasion. But I knew that I was familiar with their work, and they were great to work with and great workers. But we wanted to start off in a traditional way and talk to the spirit of the tree. I was taught to do that by an elder in Nia Bay when I lived there. His name was Clifford Johnson. And he took myself and another guy named Lance Wilkie aside, and he taught us things that he thought we needed to know. And that was one of them, to use cedar branches to brush down the log and talk to the tree, because it's still alive, and the canoe itself will still be alive, and so we wanted to make that transition as well. Now, I just saw Nick walk in, and I'd like to have him stand up, and I'd like us to appreciate him. Nick and the other three did a great job, and I was less helped than I thought I was going to be on account of being diagnosed with congestive heart failure, but fortunately I got over that. So here's the log just coming around on a boom truck ready to move into the carving shed. So you can see it's a pretty big log. It was donated by Sealaska Timber. And I have to say, it was kind of in a way unrealistic to go to Sealaska Timber a few months before, a few weeks, a few months, before we were going to start work and say, we need a canoe log. Because I think even 150 years ago, a log that had all the ideal characteristics to make a canoe out of, those trees were maybe 1 out of 50, maybe as much as 1 out of 100. And certainly, when the growing conditions were correct, there would have been small groves of trees that had those characteristics. And of course, the people would have known where those were over generations of time and made use of them. But otherwise, here and there, it's a rare thing. And of course, in commercially logging, you drop the tree, you don't really try to soften its landing, Old timers would fall smaller trees back and forth across the path so it had something softish to land on to keep it from cracking. So when I saw pictures of this log, which was one of three that Sealeska Timber had in their cultural use pile that were the right dimensions, this was by far the best of the three. And they had, they'd set aside like 30 nice cedar logs for cultural use. But they were done logging for the season, and it wouldn't start up again until, things thawed out in the spring. So we took the one that we could get. And I was aware of this big hard check running through it. Where's my pointer? There it is. big hard check, and you could tell there was a little bit of decay in the center. And I had learned to deal with that in the past, so I was confident we could do okay. And then as we got farther into it, there's that same crack as we shaped, made the first gross cut on the stern. That little bit of decay is starting to look bigger. And when we actually got the hull shaped out, this is what we were looking at. And that's why I said no one in their right mind would make a canoe out of this log. But fortunately, I'm not in my right mind. And I was confident that we could overcome all these problems. It took a lot of time, but we successfully overcame them all. So here's a couple of other views. So there's that same crack. And here we've got the bottom shaped out. We have curves that are reflecting those water lines that we saw in those lofty drawings. And those are absolutely necessary to have the canoe perform right in the water. This is the stern, and here's the same crack as it passed through the bow. Ordinarily, I would try to orient a hard check like that horizontally because it's easier to deal with, it's easier to manage. But there were other factors on the log, bark seams and whatnot, that we ended up having to orient it this way, which wasn't ideal. But we had to come up with some new techniques. And then, strangely enough, things we weren't able to anticipate, didn't know about. There's like a crack like this, that there's just a section of a slab that cracked at some point, probably when the tree fell. There were some really new looking, fresh, very fine cracks in it that weren't apparent until we got it shaped out. But even here you can see sort of some of the normal kinds of repairs, like there's a little ingrown bark area here that we cut out and patched. There's another one over here we cut out and patched. There was a place where machinery, you know, the hydraulics that they move logs with, had dinged into the log. Those are worse than cracks at that, but we managed, we had experience to work on, and we patched all those. And so here's some of those processes. So in this picture over here, we're using a chainsaw to cut the long curve in the bottom to start with. So it's a curve about this deep. And it's curved in the middle third, and then the ends go straight up to the top of that curve, because only the middle third actually bends. And that middle third, the bottom is only an inch and a half thick. And that's the same case on the Hoochyok, 44 feet, and the one in New York, 64 feet. Both of them, the bottom is an inch and a half thick. Toward the ends, it can be thicker because the ends don't bend. But if it's not thin enough to flex in the middle, then the sides won't go out. They just won't go out. And I know people that have had a hard time spreading the sides of a canoe, and that's probably the main reason, because the bottom was too thick. So then we made that, we set up an Alaska mill, you know, and we have these rails, wooden rails there, and the middle ones are sawn to a curve. So that just one pass of the saw makes this long jump curve, which is a much quicker way to do it. So here they're lifting that slab off. Here we're using it, we figured out, we carved the bottom already, and we turned it up, right side up, we measured up from the bottom to know exactly where the gums go. And then we could chain chalk lines and saw the top right off and save some pretty big pieces. It wouldn't affect those. What the end blocks came out of. This picture shows what I call the bent board technique, and this is just something that I came up with years ago to try to anticipate the shape required so that when you bend it out, it's one long, steady curve from about a stern along the gunwale. And that's how the old ones are, and the models are that way. And that's a bit tricky, but I found that by putting a piece across here with a block on it, that will be the width of the canoe after it's steamed. And bending that long splint, or whatever you want to call it, out to that point. So part of most of it's off the log, see? But where it crosses the log, that's these lines here, that's to where you carve the shape, and that's where it curves down like we saw in those historical photos. And then when the parallel part and the upper part in the middle bends out, then that line naturally fares itself out. These are some of the tools that we use that are specialized for just canoe making. Some of these I made and some of them are commercial. Those ones over here are ones I made. These are both adzes that were modified. They were existing adzes for something else that I modified into the steep curve and bent up using a forge and whatnot into a deep U shape. And the deep curve from front to back and the short handle means you can carve following those lines of thickness measuring holes down the side and curve onto the bottom of the canoe. No other adze will do that because the handle quickly gets in the way. If you used a curved adze going sideways, it would work, but then it's actually a little harder carving with the grain, especially when you're trying to find a row of pegs, but those do it pretty magically. And this is an adze that looks like it tipped over, right? The handle tipped over. But this is based on a Micronesian canoe adze that's in the burr, which was made so that you could actually rotate the blade from side to side, so that when you reached up into the narrow ends of the canoe, instead of the handle getting in the way on the opposite gunwale, then you can actually, the blade is tilted, the handle's coming out like this, so you can work down the sides of the canoe without the handle getting in the way. And then these are commercial tools. This is a Stanley number 70 box scraper, so-called. And the first time I saw one of these in the hands of an old shipwright in the San Juan Islands, he was 84 when I visited him, and I got a number of tools from him, and I'd never seen one before, but as soon as I saw it, I knew it would be a very valuable tool in a canoe, because this little plane head, like a spoke shape, I think, this is a pivoting handle, so you can pull that handle and it'll ride over curves and whatnot, so you can fare up curves, you can smooth out stuff that has been chopped out. And they're really useful tool. These are what's called a scorp or an in shape. So that's like a draw knife that's bent. And you can sharpen those up using them across the grain. You can move a lot of wood with them. They can be very aggressive. And they can also do refined wood. So they're, and you see those in old native tool collections. There's one in the bird. And I've known four former canoe builders who had these tools as well. Native canoe makers had these tools. So here's patch time. So here's TJ cutting a slot that crack in the bow, but it wasn't straight, so the patch has to be bigger than the crack itself. So here's here chiseling it out, and then we cut out another piece of wood. You can see the color doesn't match, but that's not a big deal. And we fit it snugly in that hole using the old technique of putting color on the hole and then fitting a piece of wood down in there, pulling it out and carving off where the color transfers to the other piece. And it's the only way to do it. It's an old timer's way to fit pieces of wood together. It's the same thing your gunsmith does to let a barrel into the stock, and there are other applications of that. And here's the same thing going on in the stern, that big ugly crack we looked at before. So part of it was passed with this section here. That's as this, you can't see anything here. This piece is as it's being fit. So you can see it tapers a little bit so that you can always keep going down and it'll get wider. And then these are straps that were used to glue it in because it's a taper, the glue tends to want to push it out again. And then here's where it's all shaved down smooth again and very well adhered to the wood around it. Here's a little butterfly patch of which we put a lot in, and I'll say more about those later. Then here in the bow, I mean in the stern, this is that stern crack. Once we turned the canoe right side up, started hauling it out, this is that same crack. Again, it's been widened up slightly to get a piece of wood in there, but that's what it looked like. And this is a block that Jerrod left in the canoe and actually screwed it and glued a piece of wood with the grain running across to keep those two halves together, you know, while it was being worked on. So then here he's fitted a piece of wood in there, and he's slathered it with 3M 5200 marine adhesive sealant, which I learned to call gum pookie. So he slathered that with gum pookie, and here he's fitted it down in that slot, and then we clamped it up, and that brought the stern together. Then where that rotten hole was, here he's cleaning out parts of that, and then between Jerrod and Tommy, they fitted all these different pieces. This is the piece that we saw fitted in before, so it meets up with this one and is bonded to that. This is the this big patch when it was first glued in, before it was carved to shape. This one, which is the opposite side of this one, there was a knot there that just happened to parallel the side right on the surface, and it wouldn't have stayed there, it wasn't that solid. So we had to take that out, and then Jerrod patched that in. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4 pieces of wood fit in on this side, and another 1 or 2 on the other side. And here's Tommy. This was the most challenging in some ways. I had not had to deal with a crack like this before, the other side of the bow. So here's Tommy working a slit down into that crack. That's the how wide the crack is open right there. And then, so here's his hands stuck in from the outside, in through the crack. You can see the places he's cut out. And then he very carefully fit in a number of smaller pieces, because you couldn't do it in one piece, but it would drive me crazy. But he, in block by block, he fitted different pieces in there, eventually all the way up to the top of the crack, and then we put some screws in up here. Eventually, Jerrod put a stainless steel patch across there, through bolted and countersunk on the outside, just to make sure that didn't go anywhere. So here it is, all completed, and 4 butterflies to, there were accessory parts of the crack, and then there's also a piece of rope attached to the front edge to, which we can see here, that not only helps hold the cracks closed, but gives that the soft end grain of the cedar something to protect it from impacts of any kind. Here's Nick carving down those fitted pieces after they were in the glue setup and all that. He's carving them down to shape. And here's 2 of the 3 stainless steel patches that we put in there. This was a crack running diagonally through the shape of the canoe at that point. There's almost no other way to pull it together and hold it shut. So these are through bolted. These are the countersunk ends of those bolts with nuts and washers on them to hold those pieces of stainless steel in place. So there's some high-tech solutions. Here's Tommy carving the stern block. So these ends were always added on, even the single flare type added on the ends. And the reason, one of the reasons, is because, well, you know, if you had to have a log that big and carve away everything except this little piece, you'd soon figure out that it'd make more sense to add that on. So that's what they did. And while they were adding it on, they took advantage of putting, instead of having the grain run through it this way, like it would with the rest of the tree, they turned that so the grain's running up along this surface, and that protects these thin ends from getting broken off. So then those are, originally they were pegged on, but I replaced the one in Skagway. It was a beautiful, it's the only traditional canoe of this type in the state that I know, besides the small John Wallace one. This is a 19th century canoe. It's a sitting museum in Skagway. And the bow piece on it had gotten charred at one point, so I replaced it. And it had been held on with 3 pegs, one of them the size of my thumb and 2 the size of my finger. And each one of those pegs had a little wooden wedge in each end, so that when you drove it in, those wedges would tighten up, swell up the end, and keep it from coming apart. But we used bronze light bolts instead. So here he's just roughing it out. It takes a big block of wood, but there's a lot less there when you get it done. And here it is fitted onto the canoe. Again, there's wears those patches in the stern. And here's the one fitted on the bow. It has the notch in it to hold the either a harpoon on a smaller hunting canoe or masts, river poles, whatever else. Here's that patch that TJ did, a few butterflies, and the oak cap strip on the hind ring. So here's one of those, how we made those butterflies. We made them out of yellow cedar. It's a little denser, and the object is to inlay those across the crack, just like a butterfly bandage on a cut. So the narrow part crosses the crack, and those two dovetails prevent the crack from opening up. So if you fit that in and re-inlay them about half the thickness of the hull, wherever they were at, so that varied from half an inch to maybe 5/8 or slightly more. You inlay that right down into the wood, and if you had a really tight fit, you wouldn't have to glue it. It would swell up in there and it would prevent that crack from coming apart. So that canoe in Skagway had three butterflies like that in it, which is where I got the idea to do it. So we start with a block like this, and because they're round on the ends, we cut that with a Forstner bit, which is about this end. And then we carve that whole block to that shape, and then we can take it's like a stack of butterflies. And that way they're all consistent shape. Then we can just either split it or slice it in pieces to make the individual butterflies. This is a drawing from Boaz's Quadrature of Vancouver Island, showing an older Aboriginal technique. You see these in old canoes as well, not just the one in Skagway. And so this is cedar withe, the long, thin branches of cedar peeled and then twisted when they're green. And it's like rope, it stays really strong. So that's four holes drilled on either side of the crack. And the withe working around there like a knot, and then twist it around itself, and then a little wedge driven underneath it to tighten it all up. So then we got the outside all shaped and the inside mostly all thinned out. We left a block in the middle, which we learned from an old photograph of a Haida carver who left a block in the middle because the sides get wobbly when they're only an inch thick and as long as they are. So TJ's taking that out with a saw. And then here's all four of the guys going through and making sure that every inch of that is right down to the desired thickness. As much as a 16th or certainly an 1/8 of an inch in thickness makes a difference when you go to bend it. Anywhere it's thicker, it won't bend as well. Anywhere it's thinner, it bends more. Logical. But that means that you have to spend a lot of time getting it. It's inch thick along here, gets a little thicker, it might be 2 inches up in here, might be 3 inches on the ends of the bottom to allow for some wear. But other than that, it's an inch thick all the way and it has to be absolutely consistent. So then it was time for the steaming. I've got 2 whole minutes. So SHI brought David Katzik out, and he and Chuck Miller both did prayers and songs and blessings for the canoe before we started. We had made up these rock baskets. This young man, Zach Ross, had gone out to cruise off island and brought back some fantastic volcanic rocks, best canoe rocks I ever used. I like to use the old rock method better than any other because the weight of the water and the rocks pressing the canoe supported as far apart as possible. The weight of, you know, that much, how many hundred gallons of water in the canoe this deep, and those rocks pressing down in the middle as the steam over a few hours causes the lignin between the cells of the wood to loosen up and it gets flexible. The weight pushing down on that upward bend in the middle will actually push the sides out. It's causing the ends to come up, and that causes the sides to go out. So you don't have to push the sides out. If everything's done right, they go out by themselves, right out to where you want them to be. And those rocks, those baskets made it easier to transfer the hot rocks and none of the ash and all the crud from there, several at a time, into the canoe and back again. So here it is steaming away. Here's Nick Jack and loading up some baskets. And we had a crew loading baskets and others putting them in the canoe, taking the old rocks out. So here's one of the, it's getting, you can see the sides are starting to bend now. We kept this tarp over it when it was steaming. And it gets so hot under that tarp, you can't put your hand under there. You can see some of the volume of steam happening here. And then, so this is what just before as it was leaving to go to the steaming site. So there you can see the string bells and all that. And here's what it came out afterward. So it went out to that wide. It's 16 inches wider than when we started. And you can see the gunnels are level at this stage, just like that old photograph of Metal Cabin. They start level and then they twist inward quite a bit. The last canoe I made, 35 feet, it still isn't quite finished, to be honest with you, wasn't tilted inward as far. And when it steamed out, it was tilting outward slightly. I didn't want that. So we tilted it even farther this time, and that's what I mean about trial and error. There's nobody there to say, well, you gotta do it this much, you know. So we had the evidence in the photographs and unfinished canoes and all that. So it got wider, and then you can see how the ends have changed shape. Here on the, I'm pointing, here's on the left, this is before the steaming, after it just arrived on the trailer. You can see the curve at the bottom. It's kind of like it's sagging over the trailer. And you can see how the sides are parallel and rounded outward. And then here, the bottom is straight. The ends are higher in relation to the bottom than they were. And the sides are low. So the entire thing changes shape. And if you haven't anticipated all that, it ain't going to work. So these are drawings, again, from Boas and George Hunt, recorded. Had these drawings made up of different ways of tying the thwarts into the hull. This is again using cedar wire twisted, and we opted for nylon rope. But the advantage of tying the thwarts right through the hull is if you have any kind of a hard fastener in there, a bolt or a screw or whatever, and like any wooden boat, it'll work in the waves. You know, it'll move like this. And if those thwarts and those hard fasteners are grinding in that soft cedar, it's not a good combination. But when it's tied right in, you're tied right through the hull, holes right in the hull. You can see they're sewing it in here. Jared's fitting the thwart, and here Tommy's tying it in place. Here they're going out through the hull and back in again. He's tying it up. And they end up, here he's tapping a peg in to hold the last where it comes up for the last time to keep it from unraveling. But there you can see how it goes out through the hull and back in down here. And so and they're really solid. I mean, that's, you can pick them up by that and you can do everything. You know, it's the old way, it's the way to do it. So then that's what it looked like after they got it painted up. And here everybody's happy because the paint's still wet, but they're happy to pose for a picture. Here we are on that same few hours before the, well, this was a few days, but we also took that out a few hours before so I could see what it felt like, the dedication. And here, some of the people who got in were a little afraid, you know, they hadn't learned to trust the canoe. Any canoe has a little bit of tenderness, you know, aluminum canoe, whatever. So this thing helps. And if you tense up, it gets worse and magnifies it. So here's Wilbert's son Lee, and he's sitting on one gunnel, holding on to the thwart, and they're not, Jerrod and TJ are not holding the canoe, they've got their hands there just in case. They didn't want him to get wet, but it would tip up that far, and it won't go anywhere, unless we did one on purpose in Dia Bay in the river where the water got warm. We'd stand on one gunnel and grab the thwart on the other side and lean backwards. You had to work that hard to get it to go over. We did it for practice so that we could ride it and get the water out and get back in and save our neck. So I'm only a minute or two over my time. Thank you very much.